There are still discussions about the dramaturgical fine structure of the afternoon, but I'm sure it will work wonderfully. I'm very much looking forward to our next session, which will be introduced in a second by Andrea Buddensiek. My task is at the moment to introduce her. I'm really happy that she took over the task to moderate in the afternoon, because Andrea Buddensiek not only worked here at the ZKM for many, many years, as far as I know, at least 14, 15 years between the beginning of the millennium and just a few months ago. But Andrea was also involved very strongly into the projects which were running under the three letters. I mentioned them last night already, GAM, the Global Art and the Museum project. This was really more than one project, than one research project, because there were a lot of elements, seminars, lectures, and finally a large exhibition in 2011, the Global Contemporary Art Worlds After 1989, which was shown here at the ZKM and then later at the Academy of Arts in Berlin. Many texts were produced out of this project, which she initiated and organized together with Hans Belting and Peter Weibel. Many publications, some of them are already collector's items. I just looked at the first volume in the trilogy series, and I saw on the internet it cost €480, the first volume. So no chance for you anymore to get it. But perhaps here at the ZKM there are some hidden somewhere. So take them home. Wonderful books, wonderful projects, which really opened up the discussion about arts and institutions, the discussion we had this morning in a very generous and also thought-provocative way. I think what Andrea and Hans and Peter were doing here is really something which at other places perhaps will start in 10 years, and they were very much ahead of time, and it's great that she's here with us today and tomorrow. Most recent, Andrea was guest scholar at the Getty in Los Angeles, and together with Hans Belting she was preparing there, amongst other things, definitely the book on Senghor, which they are generating at the moment. Welcome, Andrea. Please take over the stage.
Ladies and gentlemen, lieber Siegfried, thank you very much for your generous words. Well, it was a remembrance of the project we were able to run here. Well, I'm very, very happy to be invited by you back to Karlsruhe and to this inspiring and important conference. Well, our project ran until 2013, and well, this is a good occasion to re-enter the field with new questions. Therefore, thank you very much. In this session, we will look for potential spaces in Africa. Among the early attempts to create a local art scene in Africa after receiving independence, the program of Leopold Seda Senghor in the 60s and 70s was a famous episode. His school of Dakar was a controversial nationalization of Senegal art, but on the other hand provoked a new movement among local artists to fight for their own independence from any official guidelines. This year, an ambitious museum project is on its way under the heading of Musée des Civilisations Noires, which goes back to Senghor's planning. This museum project is being created also in exchange with the Musée du Quai Branly in Paris. But, well, we try to find out more. But up to the late 1980s, almost nobody in the Western art circles wanted to know about modern and contemporary art from Africa. Only then the situation changed and African art became a contested topic in the West. It was carried out by exhibitions and counter-exhibitions, starting with the heavily criticized show Primitivism in 20th Century Art at MoMA in 1984, which presented African art objects still outside of historical time and without authorship as mere influence for Western artists. Its most prominent counter-exhibition was in 1989, Magicien de la Terre in Paris, curated by Jean-Hubert Martin. But for the African critics' point of view regarding the curatorial framework, the exhibition did not escape ethnocentrism, and non-Western works were still defined only in relation to their Western counterparts. But whatever its shortcomings, the show opened a vivid dialogue. Partly in reaction to Les Magiciens de la Terre, other symbolically important exhibitions have been organized, such as Africa Explores, curated by Susan Vogel at the New Museum of Contemporary Art in New York in 1991, or Seven Stories About Modern Art in Africa, curated by Clémentine de Lis in 1995, for the Whitechapel Gallery. Clémentine de Lis invited seven artists and historians from African countries to tell and curate their own stories of art in Africa. In 2001, Okwi and Weser curated the influential itinerant exhibition The Short Century, Independence and Liberation Movements in Africa, 1945 to 1994. Starting in Munich and followed by his Documenta 11 of 2002. He reminded us of the close links between modern art production and the political situation in Africa in the 20th century. In 2001, two other curators, also from the US with African roots, Salah Hassan and Olo Ugibe, organized the exhibition Authentic Eccentric at the Venice Art Biennale, presenting conceptual artists. In 2004, Simon Njami, the Swiss-born curator and co-founder of the journal Revue Noire in Paris, curated his version with the itinerant exhibition Africa Remix, Contemporary Art of a Continent, starting at Museum Kunstpalast in Düsseldorf, where Jean-Hubert Martin was director at the time. What all these exhibitions have in common is that they were not shown at any venue in Africa. So what African art was discussed and defined in the West at that time. Today, art from Africa is no longer an exotic item on the global art market, and we don't need any longer large-scale survey exhibitions of a whole continent in order to introduce art from Africa. Since 2001, more than 10 African countries had their pavilion at the Venice Biennale, and in 2013, Angola won the prize of the best pavilion. But on the other hand, art in Africa still is struggling for consolidating its art institutions, although African art, in fact, was early on the map of globalization. In the meantime, there are some global players among African artists who have conquered the biennial world, and there are more and more curators, also female curators, who live and work in African countries and are active on a global scale at the same time. The questions which we today direct to African artists who live and work both in Africa and the West or are born outside of Africa have to be reformulated against the background of the discussion in the last century. It is mainly a post-ethnic situation in which contemporary artists develop their projects in collaboration with transnational institutions. The remaining problems are their twofold conditions, both internationally and in the African context of today. I hope for fruitful discussions which set into profile the spaces where African art institutions get energized and where in particular the energy of contemporary art can flourish. And well, in this sense, I now come to our first speakers. It's Julia Große and Yvette Mutumba. They are, let me see, yeah. They are co-founders and editors-in-chief of the art magazine and internet platform Contemporary Art and a platform for international art from African perspectives, which was initiated in 2013 by the IFA Institute in Stuttgart. Julia Große graduated in art history, German literature and media at the Ruhr University in Bochum. She worked as a junior culture editor at Springer Verlag and as an art correspondent in London for a long time for magazines like Frankfurter Allgemeine Sonntagszeitung, AD Magazine, SZ Magazine or Tageszeitung. In 2010, she published Don't Get Me Wrong, a handbook focusing on the many layers of global misunderstanding via hand gestures, which became a media hit and book of the week on CNN. Since 2013, she lives and works in Berlin and, of course, for Contemporary End. Yvette Mutumba is a senior guest researcher of the project African Art History and the Formation of a Modern Aesthetic, which runs until 2018. From 2012 to 2016, she was curator at Weltkulturenmuseum Frankfurt. And here she co-curated the major exhibitions Foreign Exchange, LHGC, Paintings, Performance, Politics, and A Labor of Love, which was nominated for the Global Fine Arts Award 2016. Did you get it? Such a pity. She studied art history at Free University Berlin and holds a PhD from Birkbeck University of London. She has published numerous texts and books on contemporary art from African perspectives as well as global art history and co-curated further projects dealing with related topics. Her recent publication includes Notes on Art and Food in Global Times for the exhibition Labor of Love. And recently, Julia and Yvette curated the African focus of the Amory Show in New York. And well, the stage is yours. Welcome, Julia and Yvette.
Okay. Let me go on full screen. Cool. Okay. Thanks for this nice introduction. Thanks so much. Yeah. As you said, I'm Julia. This is Yvette. We're the we're the founders and editors in chief of Contemporary End. Contemporary and, you know, an art magazine with a focus on contemporary art from African perspectives. We're going to talk mostly about our practice, what we do, in which context we work today. And next week, 4 years ago, it all started. We launched Contemporary End 4 years ago. And, you know, at that time we had this slightly crazy idea to found, to create this one, you know, missing platform, missing link, missing magazine, kind of linking together and connecting artistic practice from African perspectives, from Africa and the diaspora. And, you know, now looking back 4 years later, yeah, we're pretty humble and happy to say that it kind of worked out. You know, CEND has a constantly growing network of you know, supporters, artists, curators from literally all over the world, you know, from Mexico, Sao Paulo, Accra, Nairobi, Berlin, London, etc. And the same with the readership. CN is read by people not only in the West, which for us was super important because we were never interested in, you know, creating an art magazine for, you know, the Western art world, who was interested in, you know, African art. Yeah. And that's why we're so, you know, thankful and happy that people all over the world are interested in what we do. And you know, if we talk about African perspectives, we always or almost use it in a political way or as a political term. Let me just, because you know, you mentioned it in the introduction, but for us, maybe it sounds a bit cruel, but there's no such thing as African art. You know, it just doesn't exist. Because, you know, what is African art? What has, you know, a sculpture or, you know, a performance artist from Nairobi in common with a, I don't know, conceptual artist in Joburg? You know, nothing. Or what has a painter from Lagos in common with a sculpture artist from London with parents from Ghana? You know, but still there's this tendency to put, you know, this label, contemporary African art, on their production, which is just so old school in a way. And that's very important to us because what we do at Contemporary End is the complete or extreme opposite. You know, we only look at the actual status quo, which is in a, you know, intense or extreme diversity in artistic practices. You know, African perspectives means, you know, that artists from all over the globe, you know, maybe have a relation to Africa, you know, via parents or, you know, they live there, but still it doesn't matter because they all come from different contexts and different discourses. And that's what's, you know, taking place or happening on Contemporary End in, you know, all different kinds of forms, interviews, essays, comments, features, etc. We have sections, we have series. One, for example, is called Inside the Library, where we ask small libraries, you know, from Dar es Salaam to Cairo to Joburg to London, to present their, you know, most favorite or most important art books from their collection. And this is a nice example of something we start online and which transforms into something offline, yeah, because, you know, in this case we were approached by the team of the Documenta in Athens who, you know, like that series a lot and somehow want to include it into one of their programs. So, yeah, this is, as I said, something where this floating of, you know, offline and online is very important to us and, you know, very important practice of what we do to have, you know, these both elements. We have other series quite close to a heart. One is called Looking Back, because, you know, our focus is very much on the working contemporary, but still we do look back, you know, referring to Irit Rogoff's, you know, talking about, in a way, being in the middle and getting, not rich, but, you know, of historical luggage, yes, luggage or burden. You know, in our case, it's extremely important to look back because, you know, sometimes there's this cliché of contemporary African art as something that has just popped up 10 years ago, and before that there was nothing, you know, and which is obviously absolutely not true because there have been layers and, you know, so many diverse African art histories, you know, on the continent, which of course link to the contemporary art production from African perspectives now. So this link or this act of looking back is very important to us. Then we have another series or several series right now referring to the actual political status quo going on. One is called Laboratory of Solidarity, where we feature historical, but as well current, you know, artist solidarity movements all over the globe, artist groups teaming up all over the globe to work on social change. Another series is called Don't Mourn, Organize, like Mourn from Yemen, you know, interviewing in particular African-American artists, thinkers, curators on their take on, you know, the current political situation, how that impacts their work, etc. Just a short note about the name, The End. As I said, the whole term and idea of African art is not a no-go for us. We just don't use it, you know. We urgently avoid using that term because we don't believe in that whole concept of it. Because, you know, for us, first of all and foremost, an artist is contemporary and maybe a conceptual artist and maybe from Berlin and maybe the parents are from Tanzania, but there's something that should never play a role if you look at the artistic practice of that person, you know. And, you know, this summer, the big European art extravaganza coming up with, you know, events in Athens and Kassel and Münster and Basel and everything. And we're, of course, super excited to look at the, you know, list of participants and see here and there artists from African perspectives. But still, you know, there's this division of, you know, the West and the rest. And there's still, you have the feeling there's this invisible global art quota, which, you know, all the events need to tick in a way. And this is something that, you know, we shouldn't have these kind of perspectives or problems anymore. You know, as you say, starting in the middle, you know, this should be something we, you know, and we're strongly working on. Last thing, a bit, yeah, just the facts. This is us, the core team, really small core team. To the left, Aisha Diallo, our coordinator, us in the middle, obviously, and Olivia Boucher taking care of our social media. And as you see, it's a tiny team. And again, it's the same idea. You know, we're surrounded by a constantly growing network of global, you know, supporters who work with us and who are The End in a way. So if people ask, oh, where are you based? We can't say. We always say we're based where the network is, and that network is here and there and everywhere because, you know, we're a global brand, if you like, and not interested in the idea of a physical base, really. So yeah, that was a little bit about what we do online, and Yvette will talk a little bit about what we do offline.
Okay. Yes, so hello again. I'm just starting off again also with a network, which is obviously something that is not really visible in the sense that you see our magazine online and you don't really know all the people behind it, but it's really important for us to underline this, that of course this is the core team, but you know, there's like, it really, The End lives from that network of people. So there are lots of associate editors and writers and translators that all feed into the content. And of course, the bigger this network grows, the more content we can actually also put out again. And we started as an online platform, obviously coming from the idea that it was all about access. So it was really important for us, if you do this kind of platform, which is focusing on this idea of facilitating and linking perspectives from people in diaspora like us, but also people on the continent or different places, that this is obviously the easiest possible through an online tool. But it was also, at some point, we realized that there's never something like the physical object, like the physical newspaper or book. And so that's why we started, a year after our launch, we started our newsprints or newspaper issues. So this is something we started off with the Dakar Biennial in Dakar. And so the idea is that we bring out this newsprint twice a year. Maybe some of you also saw it downstairs. There are some lying on the table, so you feel free to take it. So they're for free. This is also a principle, that they don't cost anything. We'll make sure that will never be the case. And so the idea really was, for example, with this first Dakar issue, where we had a group of Dakar-based artists who wrote a manifesto on the current situation on the Dakar art scene. And it was really clear that it's very different to have like a manifesto online And have a manifesto that you have in your hands and that you read and that you sit next to someone. And we were also distributing the newspaper on the streets so that people actually that had nothing to do with the biennial or with arts actually were like, oh, what this is, and they would take it, they would read it. So it became really clear to us that next to the digital space, of course you can never ignore like the physical space and the encounter. And so that's why we've done this since then, that we have taken specific occasions like biennials. So there was the Dakar Biennial, there was the Kampala Biennial, Bamako Biennial, different events that we would take as a reason to bring out the newsprint, which would focus on a specific art scene like Kampala and Uganda or so on, but also always bring in different issues, of course, and then distribute them in these spaces of the biennials, but also beyond, of course. So it would also always go to the network that is based in all sorts of places all over. And so now here you see our latest print issue, which is also downstairs, which came out for the Sao Paulo Biennial. So that was an event where we collaborated also. We'll talk about this in a bit more. But yeah, to actually bring in another layer to the biennial in the sense that we were focusing on Afro-Brazilian perspectives, which was something that, of course, the biennial in one way or the other did also, but with this physical presence of the newspaper being at the biennial and people could take it away, having discussions around the very, very complex and very difficult visibility of Brazilian, Afro-Brazilian artists would bring in this content also to the biennial, which was not in the sense then part of their, you know, public program or other things. I will come back to these collaborations. I was just mentioning one other project we did, which was previously also said by Andrea Woodensieg, that we have done a project in New York that was last year. So this is another aspect that is happening with this platform, that also other projects grow out of this. And so this was something where we were approached by the Armory Show, which is this big art fair in New York, and they are doing these focus sections every year, and so they asked us, can you do something about Africa? We were like, no. but the idea obviously was that they wanted to bring in someone who brings in another perspective, and so they were quite open to our approach, and we said, okay, we can do something. It's going to be about African perspectives, it's going to be about our network, and of course it is an art fair, so we also did invite galleries, but the approach was different than before, so that we actually chose a selection of artists and then asked the galleries whether they would come to the fair with just this one position. So the idea really was to go as far off from that crampy feeling of art fair booths, but to make a point of giving space to one specific position in each space of each gallery, and to make a point of saying, you know, these are like young positions coming from various African perspectives, and if you wouldn't know, you wouldn't even, you know, think about this if you would walk through. And so we kind of translated what we're doing online, which is one aspect also that we really very much support also, especially younger artists, that we would show them, you know, physically by inviting the galleries, but also have like two older positions like Ibrahim El Salahi and Elena Natsui, to make the point of looking back, what Julia mentioned before, which is always this aspect of, you know, bringing in art histories and to say, okay, this didn't just pop up, so this is all somehow related. And it was a very interesting experience for us, I think, because it got this huge attention, which was quite unexpected, because we thought, especially in the US-American context, you have the African-American art scene, but we could see that this is actually a very different thing. And so it was actually something where we could find a way to also link up these perspectives, because for us, African-Americans is also in a way an African perspective, in a way that Julia said, it's a political term. And so, that was kind of the physical translation of our work, and it was great to see that it was so kind of welcomed by an audience that was very surprised to see these artworks, because they had heard before, okay, there's going to be this focus and these, you know, women doing this platform, and then they would actually go in and they were like really surprised to not see what they expected, which they thought would be African art. And so this is just an example to say like that it's like this kind of constant push that we feel like we still have to do. And maybe also coming back to the subtitle of the magazine, it's still called The National Art from African Perspectives, but actually the idea is that sooner or later, rather sooner, we actually get rid of it, and it's just contemporary end. So it initially was just because we felt like we still have to point the finger on this, that people understand that there are all these things that are happening parallelly and that are as important and as relevant. Then other things happening in the art world defined from Europe. And so the other physical translation of our work is collaboration. So in a way that's very, very important, not only online in the sense that we work with all these different writers and curators and people that bring in the input, but one example is the latest Sao Paulo print issue that I mentioned before, which actually was a collaboration with a Sao Paulo-based magazine called O Menelik, which is a magazine that's focusing on Afro-Brazilian cultures, not just visual arts, but also dance, theater, and we've known them over 3 years and have been talking a lot and have seen that we have like this sort of shared experience, but also things that are very different. And so, yeah, we talked for a while to how we could actually bring this together, and then actually this print issue was one result, but we continue this collaboration to talk about these shared experience. So what you can see, that's like just an example. You know, that's the us and other people from the O Menelik editorial team. And what we did is, apart from this print issue, that we also did a launch event in Sao Paulo, and I just mentioned that to say it was a really nice party, but that's not the point. That it was an event during the Sao Paulo Biennial when you had like this main art week where all these things happening, everybody would fly in to see the biennial, but it was an event where you had mainly Afro-Brazilian cultural producers coming, and everyone was saying this is the first time that this is happening, so that you have actually an event that is kind of part of this art world, whatever how you would call it, and that actually there is a space for people that are doing this work and that have an Afro-Brazilian background, because it's something they completely, you know, ignored, apart from, of course, a few bigger stars that have big galleries. And so this is also just to say how this digital platform we use can, or we're always trying to find ways to have like also an effect that goes beyond that and that enters, like in a way, the real life, or however you wanna call it. And then a final example is another project, what we started 2 years ago. We did the first workshop for young art writers in Lagos, and this is something we continued now together with the Ford Foundation over 2 years, where we are organizing critical writing workshops in different cities. And of course, there it is very much also about always balancing out to be also not patronizing in a way, you know, not to say like, okay, you have to write like this or that, but to actually offer a space where young art writers can get training is something that everybody here, I guess, knows. And so we invite local senior writers, international senior writers to give these workshops. But the idea is to actually, was very important to us to say, okay, it's not just like these 3 days of workshops and it's all nice and then you go and it's like, okay, cool, maybe see you, maybe not. So because there's often this problem that things they're not really sustainable. So it's like, okay, you feel better maybe about yourself that you did this, and then nothing really happens after that. And so the idea with these workshops is that they are actually the beginning. So in a sense, we have like one very kind of program sustainability, how we try to continue that. It's like a mentoring program so that people from these workshops actually can continue for at least a year after that with tutors to continue writing. They get a little stipend, and so they write texts on a regular basis, and they get feedback for the texts, and then there's, of course, this option to publish them on CN, but it's also really important to kind of, you know, connect them also with other outlets so that they get, like, this practice and possibilities to publish, but also to, you know, become part of this growing network. So we had, for example, one workshop in Nairobi in December last year, where we had people based in Nairobi, but also from Kigali in Rwanda, in Tanzania, Kampala, and us also coming in. And so it was really also about those people meeting and exchanging and discussing what are their problems, you know, why, you know, how do you get newspapers to have more cultural sections? How do you actually earn money? Should you start your own blog? And all these things, so that actually these networks go beyond just meeting at some point. So these groups, for example, they founded this WhatsApp group. They're really active on that, so they're still writing. And, you know, so that it's really something that is just a start of something that people can then also relate, and that has nothing really necessarily to do also with us too as persons. So it's really more of feeling like, okay, maybe that you can facilitate something, and then it just grows and goes on, and maybe can also, you know, result in totally different kind of collaborations that are beyond whatever we do with the platform. So this is really the idea. Yes, that's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the presentation of your interesting project. We will start also with questions from the audience. Is any? Well, so in the time you're thinking, geht nicht?
Ah, yeah.
Yeah, because I think it is a plural. It's very different if you talk about art history in Ethiopia than in Senegal. And of course, I could be more specific about it, but like just to not have to say and then count all these, just to make a point of saying that it is very different histories. And there might be links, but there also might not be. Or there might be links that are more close to something in Scandinavia than actually to what's happening in South Africa. So, yeah.
Because if we would say art history, you know, we would reduce, reduce, you know, the whole movements to one, you know, cliche or you know, to one cliche or idea what, you know, contemporary art from African perspectives is again, you know, because that is just this one art history in 54 countries, which is, yeah, crazy.
Yeah, okay.
I was wondering whether you had issues related to the fact that the project started in Germany or in the West, and how is your relationship with Africa? Sorry.
Yeah, it never really was a problem because it was pretty clear that we are speaking from a German diaspora perspective. And so it was really about saying, okay, one motivation was to say we've both worked in the European arts field, getting frustrated about a certain kind of ignorance. And so it was also, you know, one motivation about saying, okay, look, people, this is what's happening, you know? And at the same time, it was also about linking with, you know, what's happening on the continent. And actually, this was something that happened quite naturally. And it was then suddenly becoming more and more also a platform where people would say, oh, it's so great because I'm in Addis and I never really knew what's happening in Johannesburg. So it's super that you're bringing it together. So it's, but it's like a growing process, I guess. And I mean, in a way also, we are funded by the Foreign Office right now, and it's like German money, and we never hide that, its effect. But we just see it also just to use that chance that we get this money, and we are also very free. So they never, I don't know how it's with other projects, but the IFA and also the Foreign Office, they really let us do our thing. So it's really not that we have to consider this because Steinmeier has been in Tanzania or whatever, these kind of things. So that's not at all happening. So we're really quite free in a way how we produce our content. And we really always saw it as a linking between our perspectives and experiences. And, you know, for example, I wrote my PhD about contemporary art from Africa in a German cultural context at a time where I didn't even find someone to supervise me in Germany because art history departments just didn't care about these kind of topics. And so now, you know, so these kind of experience were things that would actually also then connect us with other people and working. And I think that's how it just evolved into something that become then so broad as it is now. So.
And as she, as Yvette said, it's, you know, African perspectives includes the diaspora, you know, and we are part of the diaspora. Of course, you know, rawly speaking, if we would be two German blonde girls, it would be a bit different, you know, if we would say, hey, we do this magazine now, but we have a personal link, you know, a link as part of the diaspora to the topic, and it's not a magazine about art from Africa, you know, it includes the diaspora as well, because this is, you know, as I said, we're not talking about art coming from Africa, you know.
Thank you. I'd like you to maybe elaborate on the title of the magazine, which I find really powerful, Contemporary And. And I wonder what the space that and suggests. Because I'm thinking of our third text also had this interesting reference to its own context and its own style. I'm thinking also of how a recent journal in Southeast Asia puts the word contemporary before modern, so it inverts the normal temporality. I'm also thinking about a very famous Australian magazine which was called Art in Australia. It's now called Art And. So there's interesting shifts for a long time in terms of how you define the parameters of a context, both spatially and temporally. And I was wondering how you could elaborate on the choice of your title.
Maybe start there when we had to find a title. And it was very clear for us that it shouldn't be something with Africa. And so it needed, we were just really thinking to find someone to describe the condition we are in. And I think this is what it is about, this end, because, I mean, it has been always like that, but also I think in our generation and coming generation, we are ends. We are so many things. So we have parents from this place. We grow up in Berlin. We go back to Joburg. We have maybe, as an artist, a gallery in New York, and we do a residency in Hong Kong and all these things. And I think this is really what the end brings together, that we are the all these things, and that one aspect is this, you know, with contemporary and now this maybe this affinity to what African perspectives can be or are, which is of course different than someone who might have grown up in Shanghai with German parents. And so this is like what plays with it. But I think it's really about trying to capture that in a way, what defines a generation of cultural producers that we are or that we encounter in our surroundings in a way.
Please. Thanks. Thanks for your presentation. I would like to know more about how you collaborated with people in Brazil. I've been following the work of several art historians in Brazil, working and specializing in African arts. For instance, Roberto Kunduro, who's a fantastic art historian and anthropologist. I would like to know more, because at the same time in several other countries in Latin America, there's a growing interest in African art, and there are several initiatives. Just to mention one, in the city I work in, Bogota, there's a program on art history that is going to have a focus on non-Western art practices. So there's like a lot of room for collaboration and thing and interest on your project. And somehow the window to all that has been the work done in Brazil. So I would like to know more about it.
This was Andres Burbano from Colombia. Perhaps you should add that when you speak the first time so everybody knows who you are.
We shake hands already in the morning.
Absolutely. I think Brazil, with this whole heritage that is much more really present, and was, I don't know, I think it was more really for us pretty clear that these African perspectives obviously goes beyond African American and so on and so on. And with Brazil, it came also maybe also more in a coincidence that we started off with Brazil. So I don't know whether it was like a conscious choice to say it's like a big country. It was more going there for a biennial and then meeting the people from Omenilik and then have these first discussions, but also feeling like although it is very present in a way in Brazil, different than I was like in Mexico last year, which is a completely different issue, for example, that it still felt like there are lots of things that's like starting now. So it's like we felt this sort of energy that I think was also helping in terms of how to collaborate. So with Omenilik, it was, of course, they have been working for like a couple of years focusing on this, but it was very much also in a very specific scene. So it was the scene that's already there, but it was wouldn't really go beyond that. So, and they were like starting now to find ways to actually speak up in a sense that actually other people realize that this is all happening, and that this is really interesting to see. Also, for example, when we were there, that there was a workshop where they invited people from South Africa in Brazil, and to see how, of course, there are like these connections and parallels in perceptions of black people, and also very much, I mean, it's complex, I'm not going to start with this, but what was interesting to see was that especially the people from Brazil had, for the first time, they felt like they had this space where they could talk about this and people would get it. And I think this was really an important point also of our collaboration, that although our experiences are very different in many ways, there are also certain things that, you know, really connected. And I think that made it also very productive. So it was a very, very productive collaboration, although we were like on different continents most of the time. And I think it was really amazing to see how this is something that is getting no stronger and more visible, in a sense that, not saying it hasn't been there before, but in a sense of that it is like pushing its way through platforms and spaces where they were not let in maybe before in a way. Mm-hmm. And I think that was a very interesting moment to see that it's actually happening right now. So.
And, you know, during the interviews we did, you know, with Afro-Brazilian academics, we were struck by one rather sad anecdote. One told us about, you know, I can't refer the exact figures, that, you know, the first African-American artist to do his PhD was in the 70s or 80s, no, 70s, which still seems, wow, quite late, you know. And then they said that a female Afro-Brazilian artist to do a PhD, the first, was in 2010, you know, and this was something that shocked us a lot, you know. And in the very, like, it was 2 years ago when we were, you know, in the beginning of doing research and doing first interviews with Afro-Brazilian artists and academics, etc. So, yeah.
There are two other questions. With the microphone first, lady over there, and then there.
Thank you very much. I understand that you want to be politically correct in using such exoticizing and ethnicizing words like African art. But when you look back, what do you do with the history of two movements which were always against each other, mixed each other, fighted each other, and came together and out of, like the one movement, Pan-Africanism, And on the other hand, the scene, the overseas scene. This is one question. And the second question, what do you do with the heritage of two very different cultural settings in Africa, namely the Francophone Africa and the Anglophone Africa? Does this play any role today, or what is the solution?
Maybe starting with the second question, it does play a role a lot. I mean, this is why it is in English and French, the website, because it is pretty clear that a lot of people from the Francophone art scene would rather read in French, no matter whether they might speak English or not. So I think it is a pretty clear, it is different scenes. But in a way, this is what we do. I mean, this is like, we're not saying, okay, because we speak better English, which is maybe also not true, but like focusing on that, but just to really look into these different scenes and to make a point of that there are these different scenes. And that also leads to the first question. In a way, yes, there's a Pan-African movement, but I think if we say we don't believe in African art, it's because we talk about a term that's being used in Western art history. It's not like in a sense, you can have terms that are being used in different contexts, being totally different things. And so that is really what we are talking about. It's talking about constantly being encounter this fact until today that people just ignore the complexities of the continent. And this is more something that we encounter when we say African art. It's something that if you read all the different history books that have been coming out that use this, or like from anthropologists and so on, that we say we go against this to make a point. And so I think it doesn't really necessarily exclude each other to say we don't believe in this because we don't believe in this kind of understanding of African or African art.
And talking about, you know, the term, you know, being politically correct, you know, using the term the way we use it is never driven by political correctness, you know, it's rather being beyond this, because, you know, African perspectives is a term, you know, we just need for us to describe a status quo. You know, it's not to avoid saying art from Africa because that's a bad thing, you know, it's and or to be über correct, you know, it's just to describe, you know, effect as it is, you know, that you can't reduce the different perspectives and artistic productions to one continent. Yeah.
I have just very short question, and namely, I'm curious if you collaborate with other initiatives or projects which deal with more or less the same area and the same issues. Like, for instance, there is this African Networks cluster of another road for arts education, which was initiated by the Slade Art School, namely by Emma Wanambwa Volokalu, and there are some other projects which are also dealing with this problematic. So what are your collaborations with them, and how do you link this together?
Yeah, of course. I mean, like Emma or other people, they're all also part of that network. And so it's different. Sometimes it's something which is more like a physical collaboration, but what we do is, of course, a lot of writing about these initiatives, because this is really the role where we see ourselves. So we have these outcomes of physical projects, but, you know, example, the Another Road map project is something that makes sense for us to kind of accompany and then have features or these kind of things. So this is really our main work in a sense of bringing it online so that people like can't go to the biennial or haven't been able to be part of that project can actually get an idea of what's been happening. So this is, and we are actually doing that with really a lot of projects that are kind of, I mean, it is really this kind of network. It's maybe hard to describe, but it's because obviously we as two people can't know everything, but because it's by now so many people that bring these things in, that actually also really a lot of projects that are happening are also being covered online, and that's really the main way how we do it.
because, you know, if you look at the feuilleton FAZ, you wouldn't obviously find, you know, a performance exhibition in Accra or something, you know. It would never end up, you know, in the feuilleton. You know, we experience, which is funny, that, you know, during the last couple of years, you know, finally all the art magazines, you know, jumped on the global art train, and now Art Forum is calling us, oh, you're in Dakar, can you cover the Biennale for us, and stuff like that. So suddenly they all want to have a piece of that cake, but yeah, that's the way we think, so yeah.
Okay, thank you. I think we have to go to our next speaker.